definition of principal components. So it is all about how you can compute principal component and what is the interpretation, how we can interpret. So there are various geometric, it's all about that. There is a geometry, very interesting geometry for principal component. That's where we are talking about all those interpretation and derivation approach. So there are various ways to derive the principal component. I will talk few of them. So coming to content of this lecture, first I would like to talk about how we try to see principal component, how we interpret principal component. If we are having very good idea of interpretation of principal component, then definitely it will help in derivation. Derivation would be very simple. That's just a few concepts from either from linear algebra or from optimization or from neural network. You will see easily you will get derivation of the principal component. Easily you will get, there would be no issue. So understand the interpretation of the principal component, then we will talk about the derivation of principal component. So all about that, and after that we will talk about application. So before going to that, you know that in SVD, in last class I had already discussed about few things. First thing I discussed about, you are having data set without label, various data, suppose n number of data points you are having, I varies from 1 to n, okay, and there is no label, okay. In that situation, you try to get a better representation of this one. So better representation of this one, you are coming with a data matrix. So this data matrix would be what? It is talking about, we are having n number of data set points, and each xi is what? Each xi is a random vector. That means it is denoting a person. Each xi is denoting a measurement of a person with various attributes. So first attribute, you can say that I, likewise, I, xi2, and it will go on. Suppose you are having p number of attributes, so you will get ip, okay, xip, and it is a what a column representation. It is coming in with this one. So simply, okay, ith measurement. So in that perspective, what we do, we are coming with a data matrix. So this one is with respect to first sample. This one would be with respect to second sample. Likewise, we will have n number of sample. So rows, these are talking about rows vector. So with n attribute, okay, there are n attribute. In that process, you are getting a data matrix of size n by p. In the last lecture, we had already explained. So this one is data matrix. But what is happening that also from this given data set, we come up with mean vector. So simply you can represent mean vector here by sample mean. Here we don't have complete what we call it distribution of the data. We don't have. So that's why we are having just a sample. So we come up with the sample mean. So using this what we call it data matrix and the sample mean vector, we can summarize this representation of what we call it this data matrix, and we denote it by xc. That means what is that? Here we do one thing, that we deviated all the sample by corresponding sample mean. So each sample point we deviated by corresponding sample mean. So we deviated by x mean. So this xc is actually centered data matrix. So if you are having centered data matrix, then here with respect to that, the data set is a column data set is what? Mean deviated. Each data point is mean deviated, and hence we are getting mean of here this deviated data set is what? 0. So that's the better representation we are getting here. This representation looks much better. And if you are having this one, then with the help of this center matrix, we can easily define sample covariance matrix. In last class, I discussed that. What is that? That would be 1 by n minus 1 times product of x transpose c with xc. So this is a very simple compact representation of a sample covariance matrix. X square will be denoted by covariance matrix S square, you can call it. or simply sigma we can't give notation, or simply you can call it a covariance matrix. Generally we do notify S only, capital S. Okay, so covariance matrix sigma is meant for covariance matrix of the population. Okay, if you are having information about the distribution of the population, then you talk about the covariance matrix. And here remember that always I am talking about population. What does it mean, population? Population doesn't mean that you are talking about population of India, population of world. Population means it is all about with respect to data from where data is originated. So that is the sense of population. So first we are going to talk about interpretation of the principal component. What is principal component? Then we will talk about derivation. So in the principal component, how we can interpret? So there are two different perspectives of visualizing principal component, and that's where one perspective is coming with respect to minimization of a cost function, related cost function. Another perspective is coming with respect to variance. So there we variance of the projected data, that there we are willing to maximize the variance of the projected data in a particular direction. We project all the data points in a particular direction, and after that we try to see whether in that direction variance is maximum or not. So in one sense that we are taking any arbitrary direction and we project all the data and try to maximize the variance, and in that process we are getting a principal component. So that is the process. Another approach that it is all about talking about the presentation of same input in different way. So when we are representing an input in a different way, then definitely there will be some kind of reconstruction error. So that would play the role of cost function, and if we try to minimize that cost function, that reconstruct error, then we will see that automatically we get a principal component. So that two dual structure of principal component we will see it here. Suppose we are taking a single data point, our simple point that we are calling it X. Then after that we are taking an arbitrary direction V we are taking. Okay, I'm talking right now talking about a single data point or single simple. After that what we do from the concept of linear algebra, easily we can project X in the direction of V, and that projection we denote it by V transpose X. Okay, and if provided that V happens to be direction, that means if V is a unit vector, the projection length would be just given by the dot product of X with V, and that we denote it by chair. This is the projection. Okay, then here what we do, this chair is actually talking about projected data point, and just simply you can say that projected data point in the direction of V. And if when we project data in the direction of V, then definitely there would be error. What is that error? That error happens to be X minus Z, or in further you can say that X minus V transpose X. So that is the error. This one we are calling it error, or we can call this red one is reconstruction error. So what is happening that in the process of better representation, you projected X in a particular direction V. In that process, what we do? We are losing something. So this is what this you can simply Z also you can call talk it X dash or something like that. That means X dash is a representation of new representation of X or new reconstruction of X. In that process we are losing some information. So this is the reconstruction error. That means we are reconstructing X again with the help of V. In that process we are getting reconstruction error. So always what will happen, always we are trying to minimize the reconstruction error. If you are minimizing the reconstruction error, then definitely variance will increase. Variance of projected data, the variance of Z would increase. So that's both are very much equivalent to each other. Minimizing reconstruction error is equivalent to maximizing projected data of projected variance, projected data, variance of projected data. So we can see it like this way. So we had taken a data X and just apply the Pythagoras theorem. So that we can easily can decompose this length into two a square of two length. This a square of this projected data length plus this a square of reconstruction error. Okay. So here if you try to see X is given to you, so you won't do anything with this one. This one would be fixed and this one would be constant, because data it is given to you. So once data is given to you, that like one point is given to you, 1, 2. So once point is fixed, you can simply say that point would have a fixed length. We can't do anything. But what, where we can do anything? We can do things with this component. Why? Because we are projecting data in a particular direction. So if you keep on varying the data in direction, then definitely this value will keep on changing. If this value is changing, then automatically the reconstruction error would also change. So change in value of this one also implies change in this one. So that duality we observe it here. So further, if you try to see it here, so I'm writing this norm of given vector x, our data point x, as a square of norm of projection of x in the direction of t plus a square of this reconstruction error. So here, very interesting kind of things we observe here. So what, in order to get a better representation of x, what we observe here, we observe that either we need to maximize this variance, either we need to maximize this variance. This is talking about variance in the direction of b of the data section, projected variance of projected data. Okay, either we need to maximize this variance or we need to minimize the reconstruction error. So if you perform either of these two job filter, you can perform. So if you see in PCA, we generally perform this component because we can maximize variance of projected data. And in autoencoder, you will see people are just talking about minimization of reconstruction error. Okay, so that two approach. So here it will play as a cost function. Here things are coming like maximizing variance in a particular direction. So what would be that direction? We are in search of direction. That direction, the direction in which we are observing all the projected data is having maximum variance, that we will call it first principal component. Okay. So coming to principal component, from the perspective of maximizing the variance of projected data, how we interpret it. So the first principal component, V1 is the first principal component, and Z1 would be the variance of the data, projected data in the direction of V1. It happens to be the direction, V1 is the direction, first principal component you can call it V1, it is the direction that maximize the variance of Z1. Maximize the variance of Z1 in the direction of V1, subject to condition that if here V might be of infinite length, might be of finite length. So to make problem feasible, we are putting a constant that we are maximizing variance in the direction of V1. So direction, what is the meaning of direction? Direction always says that direction vector always happens to be unit vector. That's why we are putting this constant. So we are having an objective function that variance of Z1 that happens to be V1 transpose X. And right now, remember that V1 is unknown to us. Okay, V1 is here. We try to maximize the variance with respect to what? What is the argument here? We are maximizing with respect to V1. So in that process, we are getting a direction in which we are getting maximum variance of the projected data. Okay, so by solving this optimization problem, that means we have to solve the optimization problem. What? We have to solve, maximize the variance of this one. So right now I'm writing this here. Variance of Z1. You can write it Z1. So here, remember that what is variable? Variable is here V1. Right now V1 is unknown to Z1 is what? V1 transpose X. And what condition we are maximizing? The direction of V1. And right now V1 is unknown. So with respect to V1, we are maximizing. And we are putting further condition. If you don't put any condition, definitely it is a linear function of V1. So what is meaning of here? This one is a linear component. If we are not putting any constant over V1, it could be unbounded above. So unbounded above, then we can't put get the maximum value. So we need to put a condition that we just take a direction of V1 that happens to be unit vector. That means we are taking norm of V1 happens to V1 in the unit direction. Okay. So it is just in a maximization problem with equality constant. Easily we can solve this problem by using Lagrange multiplier method in order to get P1. That optimal solution would be our P1. Now once we are having P1, we got that, we will call it first principal component. Afterward, we will go to try to find second principal component. How? That means we will try to find a direction V2 where we are projecting all the data that maximize the variance of Z2. That means projection for all the data in the direction of V2. And what is the V2? V2 is having two constants. One constant is that V2 must be again unit vector, and second condition is that v2 must be perpendicular to this, v2 must be perpendicular to q1. So there is a very interesting approach, must be perpendicular to v1. Okay, so what, why I think, so if you are taking v2 is perpendicular to v1, what does it mean? It simply says that the covariance between projected data in the direction of v1 and the direction of v2 both happens to be covariance zero, that means uncorrelated, that both the data projected in the direction of v1 and v2 are uncorrelated. Why? V1 and v2 are perpendicular to each other. So that's way, that constant, actually that constant we are willing to get, that constant, that's why we are putting this in constant. So our problem here in the case of finding second principal component is more complicated than first principal component. Why? Here our object function, that optimization problem is coming like this way. That means we are maximizing a variance of Z2, that means V transpose X subject to, so we are maximizing with respect to V2, and we have already calculated V1 from the first problem, first scenario. And in second, what we do, we are putting a condition over V2 is that norm of V2 must be 1, that means we are taking unit direction. Apart from that, there is one more condition, V2 must be perpendicular to V1. What does it say? That means dot product of V1 with V2 is 0. The criteria we are putting it, it must be 0. So these two conditions we are putting. So under these two conditions, whatever things we will get, that would be our, what we call our second principal component. Likewise, we can find jth principal component in the direction of Vj. In the direction of Vj. And what is the criteria of Vj? Vj must satisfy the condition that Vj must be perpendicular to V1, Vj must be perpendicular to V2, Vj must be perpendicular to Vj minus 1. So all those criteria it has to satisfy. So we are coming with this kind of optimization problem, that it is all about optimization problem that we are talking about. And here this Vj is satisfying that it is a unit vector. And second, that means if you find covariance of Zj with other first j minus 1 Zj, okay, then having covariance 0, that means simply we are saying that it is satisfying this kind of criteria, Vj with dot product with I should write it Vk. Dot product with Vk, k varies from 1 to j minus 1. So here, if you take dot product of Vj with Vk for k varies from 1 to j minus 1, previous direction, first j minus previous direction, j minus 1, it is having perpendicular nature. So that through that, these are solvable problems. These are simple optimizer problem. You can solve all these, and which are just involving with the, what we call it, equally constant. So you can solve this with the help of Lagrange multiplier. Okay, by defining a Lagrangian, you can easily get that solution. Okay, so what we do, we got in the process, this is the process of computation of principal component by maximizing the variance or by solving the corresponding optimizer problem. So it is what completely analytical approach. You will get analytical solution with respect to this. Okay, so now further, if you talk about interpretation of those principal component, so simply we can say that if you are projecting, we are getting V1 as the solution, V1 is the first principal component. What does it talk about? It is talking about the direction in which we observe the largest sample variance. That means what sample we had taken and we projected in a particular direction, in that direction the projected data is having maximum variance among all normalized linear combination of. Before that, prior to that, I had discussed about you are having data at hand. After that, you are taking various linear combinations. Among the various linear combinations, which one having the largest sample variance? So this, that we are coming with respect to principal component. So that's where Z1, Z2, Z3, in the process what we will get, it would be better. So here Z1 would be largest sample variance among all normalized linear combinations of the column of X. Okay, and Z2 would be what? It would have the second largest variance among all normalized linear combination of F, and also it satisfies here V2, that is the principal component V2 will satisfy that V2 is perpendicular to V1. So here you can call V1, V2, all these are what? These are latent, providing a latent representation, direction for latent representation of X, data X, data set X. Okay, so your Z1, Z2 are latent representation of data in the direction of principal component V1, V2. So simply you can say that V1, V2, all these are what? If these are principal component Z1, Z2, you can say that latent representation of the data. Latent representation. So the last piece here, if that process, what last piece principal component would be VP, and corresponding to that we are getting a latent representation of data that we are denoting by ZP, and Z2 would be the it would have the least projected variance among all those. Least, because it is decided by VP. That means at the last we are getting VP. Okay, so that's why Z1 would have the largest and ZP would have least. Okay, that is the process. Okay, what I discussed. So here if sigma is suppose that sigma that happens to be covariance matrix of the data that happens to be unknown to us, no worry, we can proceed with sample variance. That how we denote it. So what you do, get a data matrix from the data, get a data matrix, and from the data matrix get a data matrix, center data matrix, and if you are having center data matrix, you can easily define a sample covariance matrix. How? With the help of this center data matrix, X e transpose X, easily you can get it. What is the dimension of X? It is n by n. What is the dimension of X e? It would be n by n. And what is the dimension of order of this sample variance? It would be p by n. Easily you can talk about. So it matches with what is the dimension of sigma? It is p by p. What is the dimension of X? It is only p by p. So both are matches. So you can say that S is a very good estimator of sigma. Even it is an unbiased estimator of sigma that we had already discussed during the estimation process. So sigma, the S, okay, S is the sample variance, sigma is the true variance, true covariance matrix. And here you can call it not variance, it is covariance matrix. We are, why? Because we are dealing with a random vector, so it would be covariance matrix. Covariance matrix. Okay. Further, we talk about derivation. How we can derive principal component? So there would be various approach, as I told that. It is all about how to find PCA. This is a principal component. So there are two approaches. One approach is that suppose somehow you come to know there is a covariance matrix of the data point. Okay, that data set covariance is a matrix is given to you. Somehow you come to know. Okay, if you don't know that, no worry. You can get estimate of this one in place of covariance matrix. You can come up with sample covariance matrix S. That as you define it, happens to be 1 by n minus 1. Times XC transpose XC. XC is the center data matrix. I always need to say center data matrix. Center data matrix. This is the situation. So now, so from the data set, if this one is not given, then proceed with this one. This one is one approach. Another approach is that you are having a data matrix. Come up with center data matrix XC, and after that you do SVD. SVD we had already discussed it first module. What we do in SVD, we try to find two singular orthogonal matrix U and V. In that process, we decompose this center data matrix in the form of in place of sigma, I had taken notation for standard deviation that we try to decompose this matrix, any rectangle matrix A, into three matrix sigma, U times sigma times V transpose. Here remember that this sigma is different from this sigma. This sigma is covariance matrix. This sigma is what? It's talking about a diagonal matrix with the singular vector. Here element are what? Singular vectors. This sigma is coming with respect to singular vector. Or you can say that eigenvector of A into A transpose or A transpose into A. Singular value simply. Eigen diagonal element are coming as a singular value. So that's why from the singular value decomposition we can decompose data matrix into. So I want to use here a sigma because sigma I have already taken for covariance matrix. I will took here gamma or lambda. Better it is capital lambda. We are taking lambda transpose times V transpose. So we will try to find directly. We are having data from the data we are just got data matrix. We got data matrix from the data matrix. We are performing a singular value decomposition. That was the easy job, just about linear algebra. Okay, from linear algebra we can do SVD. In that process, during the process of SVD, we are getting three matrices: U sigma, U lambda, V. Okay, so what is U? What is V? And what is lambda? So lambda is again, it is talking about what? It is containing. It is a diagonal matrix. Okay, where entries are given by eigenvalue of x into x transpose or in eigen. It containing singular vector values of x. I am writing in term of all the concept diagonal singular value of x. So here we are having as singular the SVD approach. Again recall SVD. Singular value will come along diagonal. Okay. And what is V? V is talking about right singular vector. Contain right singular. These are right singular vector. Right singular vector. And U is containing left singular vector. So if you try to talk from the principal component, the right singular vector are happening to the principal component, and U is talking about the projection, projected data in the direction of those singular vector. So U is talking about Z1, Z2, Z3. V is talking about what we call it V1, V2, V3. Like that way. So V1, V2, V3, those are what we call it principal component, and U is containing the projection along with delta. If you take this representation, these two together, then it is talking about projection and that variability of the projection. It is talking about variance of the projection, how much it is varies that projected data. Simply you talk about projected data with the respect to this one, and this one is talking about the direction, principal component direction. Okay, so what are the important note here we observe with SVD? So importance of SVD approach, what we observe that the efficient algorithm exists to calculate SVD of any given matrix without even computing X transpose X. That we don't need to compute this X transpose X because it would be much complicated matrix. So just there are various algorithm, easily you can even you can use Python, and from the NumPy you can call a lot of efficient algorithm. Also you can from what we call it SciPy, also you can call a lot of algorithm which compute SVD of the matrix in a very systematic way. So computing SVD is now a standard way to, simply we can say that with the help of computation of SVD, we can easily get principal component of a data matrix. Simply we can say that we can get a principal component of data matrix. Okay. So first technique I will talk about there is one more approach that we if is, so So first one was SPD approach, second is eigen value decomposition, eigen decomposition of covariance matrix. So if you are coming with covariance matrix, if covariance matrix is not given to you, then come up with sample covariance matrix that 1 by n minus 1 times xc transpose x. Okay, this one is sample covariance matrix, or if covariance matrix is given, verified, then verified. That means if data is coming from a normal distribution, easily you will get your covariance matrix. So okay, that normal distribution might not be a standard normal distribution. So that scenario here. So suppose this one you come up with from the data matrix, you just define this what we call it sample covariance matrix. From there, what you do, you compute the eigenvalue, eigenvector of the corresponding covariance matrix. Generally, I am calling it sigma. So its notation would come like lambda. Lambda mean for eigenvalue, u mean for corresponding eigenvector unit direction. And the satisfying condition is that we are not taking what we do after finding the eigenvector, we are normalizing it in order to get unit direction. Okay, so that's why u notation is coming. So it is satisfying the condition that each u is a eigenvector of sigma. What is meaning of being an eigenvector of a matrix? That means if you apply a matrix over a vector, and then that operation is not going to change the direction of the vector, it is just changing the magnitude. So here you can observe that here we are applying sigma over uj, and then after application we are getting that there is no change in the direction of uj, it is same uj, just there is change in the magnitude by amount lambda. So in that process, those special vector uj, we are calling it eigenvector of sigma, and the lambda, the amount through which the magnitude through which it has been changed, that magnitude we are calling it eigenvalue. That is the definition of eigenvector and eigenvalue. Okay, so first, always if you are willing to understand the definition of eigenvector and eigenvalue, always first define eigenvector, then see whether there is a through what magnitude it has been scaled. So that scale amount we will call it eigenvalue. So that is the right way to understand eigenvalue, eigenvector. Okay. And in the process, what we do little bit sorting. That means we are putting those eigenvalue which are having the largest value first. That means lambda 1 is having the largest, the first most largest, lambda 2 is the second most largest, and likewise. So we are doing a proper ordering on the basis of the value of magnitude of eigenvalue. In that process, we see that there is an automatic sorting of eigenvector u1. U1 is the, what we call it, U1 is the first principal component, U is the second principal component, likewise UP will be the last principal component. So automatic direction, that ordering we are getting it here. So here we can simply see that further if we try to talk about from the eigenvalue decomposition, because here the covariance matrix always happens to be positive semidefinite. So from that perspective, if you try to decompose this matrix in the form of eigen decomposition form, so what would be the eigen decomposition? It would, so if you are taking a matrix, what is the eigen decomposition? Eigen decomposition is talking about v times lambda times v inverse. But here all we have taken unit n, and there is orthogonality property. So v inverse would be first what? Because here sigma is a positive definite matrix and symmetric in nature. Due to that, inverse of a this eigen matrix, it would be again just we will get it to just transformation of that. So v inverse of the v inverse would be what? V transpose, equal to v transpose. So through that we are getting a eigenvalue decomposition. This is eigenvalue decomposition. So if you simplify, and then if you try to see in that framework of what we call it one rank matrix, then we are writing p number of one sigma we have decomposed into p number of one rank matrix. So each one rank matrix is given by a corresponding eigenvector. So that means auto product of eigenvector. This is auto product of chief eigenvector, and just multiply with the scaling factor, or that we are calling it eigenvalue. So we are we are able to decompose the matrix. So this is the actual decomposition of the matrix. That means we had a matrix sigma as a covariance matrix for the data, and from there we decomposed that matrix into p number of one rank matrix. How we are getting those one rank matrix? We are getting one rank matrix from the outer product of the corresponding eigenvector. So we are writing like this way. U2 transpose, like that will go on up to lambda p up transpose. So this visualization is much easier. Why? Because just we are having a p number of one rank matrix, and geometry of one rank matrix is very much clear. So that's why, because in place of matrix we are dealing with a single vector. It is just a single vector u1. So that one is enough to explain everything about the one rank matrix. So that's where this decomposition, it is much easier to visualize. Okay, so what would be the jth principal component? Jth principal component we will get by uj, and what is the variance in that jth principal component? We will get variance of the projected data, zj. And how we can calculate variance in that principal component uj, in the directional principal component uj? Just we have to find the variance of the projected data in the direction of uj, that we denoted by zj, and calculate the variance. And just it will be a quadratic form of sigma in the direction of uj. And if you simplify, what does it talk about? Take this to benefit, it is talking about the eigenvalue. So variance of projected data in the direction principal component uj is given by the corresponding eigenvalue. So eigenvalue of the covariance matrix also having here very significant role in order to calculate the variance. So usually we can calculate variance. So that's why all these are regarding how to find the principal component with the help of eigen decomposition of covariance matrix. So the magnitude of so further, if you try to look into the principal component, the magnitude of ujk, it measures the importance of the kth variable to the jth principal component irrespective of the other variable. So we see further another approach that here I would like to talk about PCA as a linear autoencoder. That means we are having an autoencoder, that means two set of neural network where the activation function is a linear function, and we are taking a single layer, only input layer is there. Okay, so that in that case, in the both neural network, so a linear autoencoder, it should learn to choose the subspace. So what does that minimizes the squared distance from the data to the projected data. So in simply I would like to say that it is what, it is a squared distance from the data to projected data. It is nothing, just what we call it reconstruction error. It minimizes. So here linear autoencoder try to choose a subspace. In the process of that, it is minimizing the reconstruction error. So this is equivalent to say that the subspace which minimize the reconstruction, in the process to get a special subspace which minimize the reconstruction error, it equivalently say that maximize the variance of the projected data. So geometry, if you want to say that, you take suppose x is any data point, then first what we do, we need to find the reference point as a mean vector of all the data points. So that would be the reference point from the perspective of data matrix, center data matrix. That's why we are taking this notation. So what to do after that, this mean vector happens to be a reference point. With respect to that, we project any data point with respect to any direction. We can check in direction B. In the direction B, we are projecting. So this one is the projected part, and there is a loss. This is the loss part. So what is happening that this x tilde, we can say that it is a reconstruction of x in the direction of v. So there is definitely a reconstruction error, that we call it x tilde minus x. So we try to minimize, either we try to minimize this reconstruction error, this vertical component, or we try to maximize it. If you are minimizing this one, variance will be automatically maximize in the direction. So that is that. If you maximize this variance, this reconstruction error will be automatically minimized. That approach is happening. So same thing I can come discussing this one. So everything I am discussing from the autoencoder perspective here. So here x is fixed, and hence also mu would be fixed. That one is the mean vector of all those random vectors. And if you try to find the distance of x with respect to that mean as a reference point, then this would be always a fixed quantity. These are fixed. So we are decomposing this one into two components. This we are calling it the component along the direction of variance, what we call it in the principal component or in some direction. Okay. So this is the component. That means variance. It is related with variance of the projected data. Okay. And this one is, it is related with the reconstruction. Recursion error. Okay, so if you maximize this, this will be automatically minimized. If you minimize this, this will be automatically maximized. So what is meaning of this? So just we are trying to put in the form of average concept. So that's why we are dividing throughout by n and summing for each data point. We are having n number of data points, so summing for this concept, for there would be various points. One point could be here, another point could be here, another point could be here. So we are taking a direction and we are finding that mean vector would be unique, and we project all the data into that direction, and we took the summation over I varied from 1 to n, and after that we try to get an average representation by dividing by n. Okay. So in that process, what is happening, that we have just converted. What is the definition of this one? Try to see this one. This is the definition of variance of given data. That means this is talking about variance of given data. Okay. Then the variance of given data, we have converted it to what? Covariance of structure, simply we can say that. It has been decomposed into projected variance. This is talking about projected variance. It is talking about a particular direction. That variance we are taking in a particular direction. Plus, what is this one? This one is average reconstruction error. This one is average reconstruction error. Okay. So same thing is coming, that we would not actually solve this problem by training neural network. As why? We don't need to apply neural network here or autoencoder directly. Why? Because we had already seen in eigenvector composition of covariance matrix, also in SVD form. This one is having a closed form solution. So very simple. Due to linear structure, it is very simple to find solution of this one. So that's where we can easily get a principal component. Okay. So other thing we will cover in next class.